G'day, guys and gal. After expressing my disappointment towards GW over their treatment of the Elder and recent lore, I thought I would today focus on something they've really impressed me with. A, because I'm not some GW-hating elitist hypocrite, and B, because it's Christmas, or at least it was when I started making this video, so this is my Christmas special, everyone. No, this is a Christmas special, and that is obvious because Bjorn the Fell-Handed will be in this video, and before he got turned into a quadriplegic, he kinda looked like a really drunk, angry version of Santa. You know, the type that reminded you of your dad when you were little. Just me? Okay. Coming back to my point about being impressed with GW, they have managed to make big, square mechs with no faces, limited body language, and the same monotone voice some of the most enjoyable and fun characters in the lore who pull off some of the coolest things. These dreadnoughts are the sugar to my coffee, the G-spot to my imaginary girlfriend's gash, and the topic of today's video. Before we get started, firstly, check out this Iron Warriors converted Major Kill model by Not Alfarius. He did a great job, and like I said, if you send in images of your painted Major Kill models, then I'll show them off here. Secondly, 5 days till the end of the year, with 2,500 subscribers needed for 150k. That is a serious stretch, but I believe in us. So if you watch my stuff, like my stuff, or you're just feeling a bit charitable on this day of giving, then consider chucking me your sub. It would really tickle my pickle on my quest for internet validation. Today we'll go over the top 5 best Dreadnought characters in Warhammer 40k. Best is relative, but I'll be aiming for the most interesting, most powerful, most enjoyable, or just straight up most badass Dreadnoughts for this list. If this video does well, then I'll cover a lot more stuff to do with Dreadnoughts in the future. So chop us a like and comment what you drank for Christmas. I had a lot of champagne and my brain is still fuzzy. Let's get into it. Starting us off in spot number 5 is Brother Severus, an ultramarine dreadnought, cause as Matt Ward says, ultramarines are the best! To Severus's credit, he is a bit of an absolute beast. To kick off this career, old mate Severus won a very difficult multi-planetary competition, where over 1/3 of the participants died, just so he could apply to be an ultramarine. From there, he quickly went up the ranks after achieving victory upon victory, until he was an honored member of the ultramarine's first company. However, being in the first company doesn't protect you from being blown up by the greenskins. Hence, during the hectic Battle of Corinth, Severus got wrecked. Fortunately for Space Marines, being blown up is often just a minor inconvenience, hence Severus's now abortion-like body was placed into a dreadnought, so that even in death, he may still serve. Severus adapted well to his high-budget death machine wheelchair, and continued to distinguish himself, fighting against the dreaded Tau. None of this could compare to his greatest achievement of all though, being the first person in the entire Imperium to kill a Hive Tyrant in close combat. I mean, he had help, but he was the one that charged the Tyrant and started MMAing it, so I would say he gets the prize money. He recovered from this and continues to fight along the Ultramarines to this very day. Next on this list, we have Moriar the Chosen, who is definitely the scariest dreadnought on this list and likely the entire galaxy. When a Blood Angel falls to the Black Rage, they become extremely overpowered. Their speed, strength, and ferocity goes through the roof, and their already small fear of death completely vanishes. When Sanguinis died and all the Blood Angels entered into a temporary Black Rage, they were able to slaughter most of the Traitor Legion's armies, despite being horribly outnumbered. These guys are what Khorne wishes he had, but no amount of nails in the brain will let a World Eater get even remotely as cool as these guys. So now imagine that. Then put it in a fucking dreadnought and you have Moriar the Chosen, a batshit insane walking tank that more or less cannot be killed. Moriar wasn't always like this though, he was once a respected Blood Angels captain who was cut down by the Elder. Now Moriar was quite level headed and Blood Angel dreadnoughts pretty much never fall to the Black Rage, so it was quite a surprise that Moriar did. But to be fair, if I was beaten by an Elder, I would probably enter the Black Rage as well. To make matters even worse, Moriar had also fallen to the Red Thirst, and due to his unstoppable nature, the Blood Angels had no option but to modify his dreadnought's chassis so that he could also drink blood. To be honest, as bad as it sounds, the mental image of this fetus looking motherfucker seizuring in his dreadnought in a blood rage all the time is pretty funny. Like, they can't really move what's left of their limbs, so they're literal nuggets, and the fact that this one is like a loyalist disabled Satan reborn is quite cute. Next on this list is a dreadnought so sad, angry, and alone that we all just want to give him a big hug, even though it would surely kill us. Chiron of the Lamenters chapter. Charon has been a dreadnought for ages and had been attached to the Death Watch for the time since we've known him. He's like a grumpy old father to his squad mates, but due to his status as a Lamenter, he obviously cares deeply for them. Unfortunately, Charon got word that the Lamenters got nommed on by some Tyranids, hence he believed himself to be the last of the Lamenters. They didn't actually get completely nommed and even received Primaris reinforcements, so they're currently doing better than ever, but Charon isn't aware of that. So he's just kind of sulking slash taking out his revenge against Xenos. The thing I really like about Charon though is that he just doesn't give a fuck. On one of his missions, he was ordered to capture a Tyranid lifeform alive so the Inquisition could do some weird Inquisition shit to it. Charon was like, "Get fucked," and squashed it. The Inquisition was then like, "Don't mess with us. We have you kicked out of the Death Watch. Death Watcher, remove that dreadnought." But trying to get Charon arrested by his brothers is like that scene from Halo when that captain tries to get the Master Chief arrested.
"I am ordering you to surrender that AI!"
"No, sir."
"Lieutenant! Arrest that man!"
"Captain!"
"Arrest him!"
"Captain!"
It's just not gonna happen. And even if they did try, Charon is a big angry dreadnought with absolutely nothing to lose. Good luck with that. There's a funny scene with Charon where he gets split up from his squad and ambushed by hundreds of Gene Stealers who are heavily armed. The squad doesn't see the battle, but when they arrive, all they see is a mountain of corpses and guts everywhere. Then Charon pops out of the mountain and is like, "Boo, I was hiding in case more Gene Stealers came, so I could jump out and then turn them into sashimi as well." That's not the direct quote, but it's more or less accurate. Next on this list is everyone's favourite Space Wolf, Bjorn the Fell-Handed. This old man is the oldest known living loyalist space marine at the moment, fighting since the dawn of Leman Russ all the way till now, making him over 10,000 years old. A dreadnought kicks a lot of ass, so nearly 10,000 years of ass kicking makes Bjorn a legendary ass kicker. Originally a brash space wolf who fought alongside his Primarch throughout the Great Crusade, Bjorn was a legendary warrior. He killed demons that should have been unkillable for a space wolf, purely through hitting them really fucking hard a lot of times. He lost his arm while fighting an overpowered demon that could kill you with one touch, as whilst Bjorn was smashing it to pieces, it was able to grab his arm and poison it. Luckily his mate chopped it off in time, but Bjorn was pretty chill about the whole thing. This would kind of relate to how he got the name Bjorn the Fell-Handed. He would go on and swear vengeance against a demon king who slaughtered a bunch of his mates. Now this demon king was a job for a Primarch, not a space marine, hence Russ was like, "Yo Bjorne, I know you declared jihad on the demon king, but you just aren't a high enough level yet, laddie." Bjorn replied by killing said demon king in a 1v1 by tearing out its throat whilst Leman looked on proudly. This is the second part of where the Fell-Handed nickname comes on, because he ripped it out with his hand. Bjorn is a beast. To reward Bjorn, he and a number of other legendary space wolves became a part of Leman's wolf guard, and he would fight alongside the wolves in the burning of Prospero and throughout the Horus Heresy. Eventually Leman was like, "Alright, see ya," and left the space wolves, taking every single member of the wolf guard with him other than Bjorn. Bjorn thought that was because he was unworthy, but in reality, he was the worthiest. By leaving Bjorn, Leman had unspokenly declared Bjorn to be his successor, a new leader of the Space Wolves. Bjorn led the Wolves well until he suffered devastating injuries in battle and was chucked in a dreadnought. Having a big old dreadnought as your chapter master wasn't really a vibe though, so Bjorn stepped down into an advisor slash use me whenever you want to fuck someone up kind of role. He was like the Space Wolves avatar of Kane, but actually achieved something. When Bjorn became a dreadnought, he was already quite old, even for a space marine, and he only became older with time. Like I said, he's over 10,000 years old now, and he can't be active the entire time, otherwise he would eventually rot away. Hence Bjorn is put into stasis and comes out in the wolf's time of need, such as when Bjorn dueled Magnus the Red and held him off long enough for reinforcements to arrive. Yes, that's right, he dueled against and even wounded a Primarch pretty badly. Bjorn also awakens once every millennium to tell the young space wolves to eat their veggies and to stop fucking dogs because it's giving them a bad name on the internet. You know, important wisdom like that. Another key moment for Bjorn was ending the space wolves' war against the Inquisition by more or less telling them to behave or he would smack both of them. Bjorn the Fell-Handed, Bjorn the Beast. Finally, our number one spot, Rylanor. Now, Rylanor isn't the oldest or most powerful or even the most interesting on this list. He was a legend amongst the Emperor's children, and his legend only grew when those pesky Elder forced him into a Dreadnought. It's the single act he performed later, my favourite moment in the entirety of the Warhammer 40k universe, that has landed him as my number one Dreadnought. When Horus went a bit weird and betrayed the Emperor along with some other weird units like Fulgrim, Rylanor obviously stayed loyal because he wasn't weird. As such, he was sent down to Istvan III to die. Due to Sol Tavit's warning, Rylanor was able to take cover from the initial virus bombing of the world and then fought in the subsequent battles until the world got nuked again and he was forced to take shelter in a hidden bunker. Rylanor stayed in that bunker for 1,000 years or so, slowly building a homing beacon using dead noise marine tech, as well as putting together his own virus bomb. When he was ready, he put out a beacon design for Fulgrim, probably something like some fucked up video that only he would like. The Thousand Sons intercepted the beacon and sent a couple of their dudes to have a look at who would make something so cooked. They arrived to find a broken and damaged but still living and proud Rylanor, who quickly sees through their bullshit and is like, "Where is my slutty snake daddy?" So that came out a bit weirdly. Rylanor really hated Fulgrim, but slutty snake daddy just seems really like an appropriate nickname for him. Fulgrim then randomly pops out of the shadows because, you know, he couldn't resist the good old call out. Fulgrim then taunts Rylanor, and Rylanor responds by detonating the virus bomb. Unfortunately for Rylanor, the Thousand Sons are able to contain the blast through magic, so Fulgrim continues to taunt, then torture Rylanor, telling him he will remake him in a corrupted form, which disgusts Rylanor to the max. Rylanor spits out some mad truths on Fulgrim though. As Fulgrim has been a creep and touching Rylanor's body, the Thousand Sons are like, "Fuck this," and decide to kill themselves via allowing the bomb to explode as a great big fuck you to Fulgrim. That's right, Rylanor was so awesome that he indirectly convinced three very traitorous marines to kill themselves just to spite Fulgrim. Rylanor also died and Fulgrim survived because he's Fulgrim, but his pride was forever damaged and he has never gotten over what happened. I haven't done this scene justice just by talking about it, so I recommend reading it and then watching Rylanor's Last Stand by Stringstorm, which is a masterfully created music rendition of the scene. I know the entire song word for word, it's fucked, I think I've listened to it well over 100 times. Dreadnoughts are seriously fun characters. Their beastliness combined with their hilariously dry and literal humor makes them really enjoyable. The top 5 here all have a special place in my heart, especially Rylanor. And that does us for today guys, the top 5 Dreadnought characters of Warhammer 40k. If you enjoyed the video and want to support the channel, then Patreon is the place to be, where only $1 per month give you access to a boatload of Warhammer hentai. Fuck it, if this video does well, I'll get Dreadnought hentai made. Hit the subscribe button, then hit the real subscribe button for more dreadful content. Join the Discord for more memes, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace.